Welcome back to the broadcast of Your Next Move Grand Chess Tour. This is Grandmaster Jan Gustafsson. I'm International Master Anna Rudolph. We are on location in the town hall of Leuven in Belgium, where round 8 is about to begin. And this is the beautiful playing hall in a 3-story late Gothic style building built in the 15th century. Your turn, Jan.
Yeah, there's another big encounter coming up. Our leader Vishyanand has the black pieces against Magnus Carlsen, who's won his 2 games so far, has been closing in on the leaders, I believe. How far is he behind? Only 1 point now with the counting system we're using, where you get 2 points for a victory. So Magnus Carlsen, by defeating Vishy, could overtake him. Vishy just lost his first game to his old rival, Vladimir Kramnik. Let's see how he can bounce back. Not an easy pairing to recover from a loss to face Magnus with the black pieces. Of course, there's more than that, but this is the main game of the round. Aronia Nakamura is always a good fight. Vladimir Kramnik has been looking like his very strong technician self today. Now black against Fabiano Caruana. A lot of action, and the games have started.
And Vasily, so with the white pieces against Anish Giri, Anish has lost both of his games today, while Vasily so is in the lead with Vishy Anand. So we shall see if Vasily can win yet another game.
We see the good old anti-Berlin in Caruana against Kramnik. Caruana changed lines after losing this bishop takes c6 against Levon in the last round, even though it hardly had anything to do with the opening. Let's see what Magnus chooses. Magnus is not above the trends, at least with white. With black, we've seen him play the Caro-Kann last round, but with white, he joins the discussion of the Gioco Piano, which Vishyanand himself has put to good use many a time. Even in this tournament, he just defeated Anish Giri with it.
Let's see which line they choose, because we have seen the Italian many times here, also in Paris. Somewhat less popular than the Spanish and the Berlin, anti-Berlin variations, but still plenty of games between these players, the elite players of the chess world.
Vishy is old school. He chose the setup, which I also learned. You go d6, a6, and bishop a7, pretty much against everything. The new angle that has brought this line back to popularity is white playing a4 here instead of the old-fashioned bishop to b3. They've decided a4 is a more useful thing to do. And that's what Magnus Carlsen has put on the board. Anand goes bishop a7. Here we've seen plenty of moves in recent times. h3, rook e1, knight bd2, knight to a3. We'll see what angle Magnus chooses. And I keep being surprised that this line keeps popping up and keeps yielding good results. There might be something more to it than the eye test reveals. Very sharp line. Oh, and a bit of a personal favorite in Wesley So against Anish Giri.
This Which line is this one? This is
the Meran Semislav bishop d6, bishop d3. Hotly disputed line. I somehow ended up having this position 3 times in the only tournament I play, in the Thailand Open recently. And rook c8, that was one of my games, b4. Here the trendy move used to be c5 with very, very sharp play. That's what happened in my game. But Anish has his own opinion, and he goes for the move a5. Not a novelty. He's already employed this in the candidates against Sergey Kayakin. So the always well-prepared Wesley So surely had a look at that game and comes up with his own idea here, rook b1. If I remember correctly, Kayakin played queen b3. Wesley goes rook b1. I also checked this, and black has the option of going c5 here, which looks very, very nutty, but it does seem to work. B takes c5, and bishop takes f3. Oops, sorry. Bishop takes f3. With crazy complications, the big point of black's play is after g takes f, you sacrifice a piece. Knight takes c5, d takes c, rook takes c5, and it turns out it's not so easy for white to keep his extra material. It's a threat of rook g5 check, and there's a threat of ganging up on this pinned knight with queen c7 followed by rook c8. Normally they have this position without the inclusion of a5 and rook to b1 though, and Wesley tries to use that fact by going rook takes b5 here, which I'm a little confused. What black is supposed to do, if Anish mixed up the move order, or what is going on?
Anish is trying to recall what is the variation. Is it possible that he has mixed things up?
I doubt it, because normally he doesn't, but let me just, for clarity, show the normal line. It's c5 immediately, takes, rook takes, and in this position, of course, there's no rook takes b5, so normally they play f4, queen c7, no, f4, knight d5, bishop d2. something like this, and win back the bishop. But after rook takes b5, that is no longer possible.
Knight e5 has been played very quickly. We see that both players have more than 25 minutes. They started the game with 25 minutes, and now it's just that this is going
to be a
draw.
Looks like this is a forced draw. Yeah, was a memory test, and Anish shows that you can make a draw even in this move order. Rook c5, queen g5, king h1, queen h5, and a perpetual ensues because you can't parry both threats. Therefore, f4, queen f3. Wesley sticks to his policy of playing solidly. He doesn't mind theoretical discussions, but if his opponent doesn't mind a draw, he does not seem
solid
to object all that much.
He is in the lead even with this draw, so Vesi Sona has 10 points out of 16. Only Vishy Anand could catch him and Magnus Carlsen and Levon Aronian in case they win their games.
Yeah. I'm not sure if Wesley missed this in his home preparation, but I don't think so because the computer was showing these lines, therefore he probably didn't seem to mind so much. Magnus Carlsen would mind a draw here, but will he be able to do any better? Knight a3 has been played. This is another idea that is made possible by the early a4. This knight goes to c2, preparing bishop to e3. All of this looks like fairly sensible. Also the move knight to g4. Black is trying to exchange one pair of minor pieces. I'm always surprised, as I said, that white manages to generate some initiative here, but they've been doing that on a consistent basis, sometimes even relying on this little extra space on the queen side in some lines. B7 could become a target. And I think I've seen this position before, queen b3 here. We'll see if Magnus continues to continues his streak and wins another game. He's played h3, daring Black, or not really daring, he's going to asking Black to take on e3. It's very double-edged. Black has a sounder structure, but if White manages to play all the active moves he would like to play, ganging up on the f7 pawn and putting pressure on b7, there can be some questions to answer for Vishy Anand. Another typical plan is queen e1 followed by queen g3. So yeah, theoretical debate here.
What's happening between Vashier and Topalov?
Hang on, there's another position that sparked my interest.
Oh, what is this?
I believe this is also all theory. And I'm surprised because I think this is supposed to be just bad for Black. So either Hikaru has a different opinion or he's mixed up something. This is all theory, queen a5, a3. And this idea was supposed to give big, big problems for Black. You sacrifice an exchange. B4, knight takes c3. It's a whole rook down, but you get the knight back after queen a1. What they normally do is queen a4, queen takes c3, a5, b5, knight takes c5, trying to activate. Because if White manages to consolidate here, he's gonna have an overwhelming position, even though he's an exchange down. If you manage to, whatever, go bishop e2 and castles. These pawns are just too strong. The bishop can go to e7. So this line is supposed to be bad for Black, and I know that because I'm the only player who ever lost this position with White after a5, b5, knight c5, queen c5.
How did you lose it?
I can't recall. I believe they go bishop f5, and there was some very clever way to stabilize here, something like queen c3, rook c8, queen to a1, which I missed, followed by knight d4. Something along those lines. I'm very curious if Hikaru has a novelty up his sleeve or if he's just gone in for a dodgy variation. Because last time I checked, this was just supposed to be bad for Black.
Do you think now he's trying to recall that, was it that this variation was bad and I already ended up playing it?
I think so, because curiously, there is a connective variation that is playable for Black. It's not forced, but if you do the same thing with h6, bishop h4 included, then this position becomes playable. One key difference is that this bishop is hanging in some lines. I can't remember details, but it was
with bishop g4 or how?
I'm not sure. Maybe it was bishop g4 here or bishop f5 anyway. This was a game between Aronian and Kramnik a long time ago, and this is playable for Black. But the position they have on the board, I thought it was supposed to be just bad, and the tricky part was the part I failed at, to find this maneuver, queen c3 and queen a1. I'm curious if Levon will find this or if he's gonna have a different opinion. I think I played something else, bishop e2, and the position wasn't so clear, but I believe this was more or less winning.
Do you think is that he forgot to play h6? He was meant to play the other variation that you showed?
I'm not sure. I haven't checked this with new computers. There we see Chris Little, John Hikaru's second. Maybe he has come up with something here. My knowledge, which is a few years dated, was that after queen c3, queen a1, knight d4, black was in big trouble here. So I'm very surprised Hikaru went for this. But I'm also very curious if they have some fresh ideas. Or maybe he's bluffing because... tempted to switch on the computer to confirm what I'm saying, but yeah, I'm reasonably sure. You have to find this queen c3, queen a1 maneuver, which is not the most intuitive way to play, but this is a position guys have analyzed, so if I know this, I would expect Levon to know this as well. And yeah, queen c3, queen a1 looks strange, but the queen can't be bothered in the corner. Then the knight goes to d4, and black is borderline lost, so I'm very surprised. Looks like Hikaru either makes up something or he bluffed this line.
Perhaps he forgot to play h6. Maybe later on we will at some point have the chance to ask him. But if this game goes badly for him, I guess we will have to wait for tomorrow to interview Hikaru about this game.
Yeah, we'll find out. But it could also be half a bluff because it's queen c3, queen a1. As I said, I had this position in a tournament game. I didn't manage to find that. The only reason I know it is because I checked it afterwards. And it's not the easiest maneuver to put your queen in the corner, but Levon, of course, is capable of finding such stuff, and if he does, then it's gonna be very, very wearing. I played this, but then the game became very unclear. Rook c8, queen, I think I played queen d4, queen takes, or rook c1 check, followed by queen takes a3. Was a mess, and I didn't enjoy it all that much. So we'll see how it goes. Let's see what else is going on. We have the anti-Berlin between Caruana and Kramnik, fashionable line with knight e7. All the normal moves, a4, Kramnik goes a6. He's been showing some fresh ways here. Most guys have been playing a5.
And you guys can see our great audience here in the Town Hall of Leuven. Hello, everyone. This is a hi to the world from Leuven. I think we have a very happy audience since Belgium has won.
Sure. Yeah, there's a theoretical debate here. I'm not a specialist in this line, I have to admit, but Kramnik and Caruana are both at the forefront of all these developments. A6 is rare. Kramnik has been doing well here, showing different ideas. He's defeated Veselin Topalov in Paris, I believe, in this line with black. He had a good game earlier in this tournament. I can't remember. They played this line too much. Kramnik certainly knows what he's doing. Fabiano is trying to develop his pieces. If he can do so without being bothered, he should be a little better. So I'm curious what Kramnik is up to, if he wants to go d5 or what the plan is here. I don't dare to argue with the experts.
We shall see that, and also we shall see if Aronian remembers queen c3. Do you think he played it already, or what happened in that game?
He has played queen c3. As suspected, he's capable of either finding that or recalling it, because it's a position everybody that plays this line has on their laptops. And yeah, I'm very surprised Hikaru went for this, because once the queen gets to the corner, there's just nothing to do for black. Knight d4, bishop e2, short castles, and more or less resigns. So Hikaru must have been bluffing or mixed something up.
What's happening in the very rare matchup of Carlsen Anand?
Just to conclude our tour,
briefly
have a look at
MBL. We missed Vashier Topalov, sorry about that.
Versus Topalov. Well, they already have an endgame on the board, equal material if I can count correctly. And then, yeah, it shouldn't be any big troubles for Veselin Topalov. Maybe knight c7 to not have anything too bad happen from the a7 square.
What can you tell from Maxim's body language? Is this way of sitting showing confidence, or the other way around?
I think guys are just getting tired. Today it's only four games, this is the third one, so less tired, but to lean back a little bit is always a nice way to rest. I'm not sure it means he likes his position or not. Knight c7 is on the board by Topalov. Yeah, looks equal to me. White is slightly better. He has the passed pawn and could try to make something happen, but I really, really doubt that this poses big problems. in Carlsen-Anand, yeah, we have a typical structure for this line where both sides have these weird double pawns. And Carlsen can decide if he wants to make it even more picturesque by going for this.
That would be interesting to have this pawn structure, but I do prefer white thanks to the queen on b3, which is attacking both the e6 weak pawn and the backward pawn on b7. So if black could have something similar, that would be great, but he is just defending with his queen from e7. Not that it's a big deal, but it's an issue that turns this position into white's favor.
Yeah, still looks reasonably, well, defensible at least to me. Queen c5 might be a threat at some point. So let's say queen c4 and you start exchanging pieces. Shouldn't be too troublesome for Vichy, and I would guess Magnus tries something more ambitious, keeping the tension, not going d takes e5, but no, a move like rook f2 in order to be able to double on either the f or the d file and ask some questions. Both sides have been playing quickly, so it's possible they've both considered at least similar positions, if not this very position. Vichy doesn't look unduly concerned to me.
Maybe there's no trouble, but as we remember, Vichy has lost several games against Magnus that were drawish or equal, so I think he should be extra careful about his play.
Yeah, and especially in this pawn structure with pawns on e4 and e3, he lost a key game in the World Championship on the white side, so he's certainly reluctant to enter that structure, but here was Magnus who invited to play it.
And they both had it, so
pawns.
As you said, beautiful image with these four pawns on the e-file.
Yeah, Carlsen's trying to come up with a plan. Yeah, to my mind, rook f2 intending to double rooks. Looks very natural. Queen c4 is a useful little strengthening move. But then d5. And after all these explanations, I finally realized it is actually black to move. So rook f2 is not legal. You have to wait for Vichy to come up with something first because he just played rook a to d1. I'm not sure if Vichy can do anything.
Anything
constructive,
active.
Though ed4, I don't think you want to play because after ed4, white structure improves and black would have to go for, let's say, d5, but there's always the worry that you end up with a weak pawn on e6.
Yeah, so, and you don't want to capture on e4, so.
Yeah, I don't think he wants that, and I would guess he also is going to have to play some sort of waiting move like rook to f6. Or maybe just copy what Magnus just did, go rook ad8, and say, yeah, whatever. If you want to exchange everything, we can do that. But I can defend this position.
I think he will not capture on e5 and try to do something else, try to keep the knight on the board. Could he maneuver this knight towards c4, or that's too slow? And I don't know if it makes much sense. I'll just try to do something about this position.
Yeah, not sure. It allows black some exchanges, which
and then rook
I
f8.
Guess help his defensive task, if he so chooses.
Yeah, but if you have to keep the knight on f3, what's the way of improving? Doubling rooks, but still.
We shall find out. Vichy played rook ae8, defending this e6 pawn an extra time in case it's needed.
Well, in this case, maybe it makes sense to double rooks on the d-file.
Yeah, certainly rook d2 or rook f2, once again, are candidates. Queen b4, maybe, fishing for weaknesses here. Very strange pawn structure. Magnus has the smallest of advantages, but so far the balance doesn't seem seriously disturbed.
But he really enjoys playing positions like this, so I think he's happy with what he has on the board.
Sure. Levon Aronian concluded this queen maneuver to a1. Yeah, I've said it all. It's all known, I believe, even this queen c3, queen a1. It's either been played or people have seen it when they analyze this line because this is what the computer wanted. And this position is winning for white if nothing dramatic is in store, but since Hikaru is taking time, it looks like he's just mixed up something. Very rare opening mishap for Nakamura, who's normally very well prepared. Because, yeah, this just plays itself, knight d4, bishop e2, and more or less resigns.
Yeah, and it's winning because it's two minor pieces for the rook, and there's not even a pawn accompanying the rook. Also, you will have very active minor pieces.
Yeah, very strange. We're going to have to find out what motivated Hikaru to go for this. My best guess is he confused it with the line where h6, bishop h4 is included, where these things are indeed playable.
Do you think that Levon is superstitious and we are bringing him luck? Since we interviewed him, he is just winning all his games.
Yes, I believe that is a likely explanation.
So I thought so.
He was going to be back here soon. Queen c2 played by Nakamura. This has also been seen. I think you just go bishop e2. Queen c1 takes, bishop d1. And yeah, black doesn't have enough activity. Bishop c2, king d2. And if no bishop c2, still the usual, knight d4, a4 if needed, king d2, and white slowly crawls out. There's also the threat of e4, which you have to pay some attention to, because his bishop is still here. So yeah,
this,
as mentioned,
isn't promising any good for Hikaru Nakamura, who is not having the best tournament here. He has played brilliantly in Paris, with some mistakes, of course, especially in the Blitz, but that happens to everybody. Very short time rate, 5 minutes with 2 second increment. But he won in Paris very convincingly, and here in Leuven he seems to be suffering.
Yep, of course, the game isn't over. Leuven went knight d4 instead of bishop e2. It's probably even stronger. Queen c1 takes. King d2, rook ac8, I would guess. You can't take yet, or can you? Maybe you can take. Feeling you're not supposed to, but my memory bank is running out of storage. Can't refute this either, though.
So you're saying that it's not possible to go for this line with queen c1, then rook ac8, giving up the bishop?
I could make it work. Like, white is not forced to take on f5, but if it works, of course you do it. And I couldn't see anything here. There's no perpetual, at least none apparent to me. And black is just so much material down. Knight d5 would clarify the situation.
King d2, rook ac8, and Aronian is capturing the bishop. This should be game over unless we are missing something.
Yeah, I don't think so. And as mentioned, it's a theory victory. Very, very rare occurrence for Hikaru. Must have mixed something up. Takes on f2, tries to keep the game going with his active rooks.
But many ways lead to Rome.
You can go knight g3, you can even give the bishop back, like, I don't know, knight e7, king f8, knight takes d5, because such a position is also fairly hopeless with the two minor pieces, whatever, bishop f4. So, yeah, of course, you still have to wrap it up, but it does look like white should win this. Bishop f4, maybe to.
That's not a very fortunate game for Hikaru Nakamura. We don't know if he forgot playing h6 or what happened to him.
Let's check back in with Caruana versus Kramnik. Kramnik's position looks a little risky strategically, but he's banking on active piece play. He didn't do any pawn breaks in the center, just went for knight h5, knight f4. Probably pushed for this. I guess bishop f1, typical move to stop any knight h3 shenanigans. And black better be quick here, because if he's not, first of all, e5 is hanging, and secondly, if white manages to consolidate here, king h2, g3, he's going to have a serious edge. c7 is a target, white is a space advantage. It's not very pleasant. But as usual, I'm missing tactics left and right. There could be
The pin.
Problems with the d5 pawn. That changes things a little bit.
So the position is?
This is the position, and I said bishop f1, but
yeah,
then I realized
we
this was hanging.
Played because of the pin on the b1 h7 diagonal.
Then you have to calculate, which I will leave to Fabiano. Maybe knight takes e5 immediately is playable. Can't see why not at first glance.
this, maybe.
And if g takes, queen takes.
Doesn't really look like enough, but who knows?
You mean that could be a perpetual? Like?
I don't know, I'm just fishing for something, but yeah, I can't really see anything. Even bishop f1 here, queen g3, bishop g2. And there doesn't seem to be a way forward. We'll see what Fabiano decides on. For now, I can't refute knight takes e5. Yeah, seems to work. What else is going on? Game so geary. And in a draw a while ago after they compared notes in one of the sharper theoretical lines out there, but yeah, nothing. It wasn't in both guys' computers. Magnus Carlsen, interestingly, after ed4, he's gone c takes d4, not undoubling his pawns. He thinks it's more important to keep control of the f4 square. Played cd and Vichy, followed up with e5. Probably that was his point, no matter if ed or cd, to just release the tension in the center. Now ed4 is a threat because e4 would be weak.
Yeah, in the game you mentioned, with I think with opposite colors, it was the move, the very same pawn structure, and d5 had to be played, but Vichy didn't. Was it with the opposite colors or not?
I just know
that he missed to play it because he didn't want to keep his pawns on e4 and e3. Like, they look weak, but he had to keep the center closed.
Yeah, d5 will be a concession from white after c5. Only black can be better, so you don't want to do that unless you really have to.
He took on e5.
Takes on e5, but this is not playing for an advantage. It means that Vichy solved all his problems, d5. And this is the drawback of going for these double pawns, that they can end up being isolated and weak if things go a little bit wrong, so it's quite committal in a way. Not sure if Magnus is in serious trouble or anything. Well, queen c4, king h8, b4. He's probably doing all right, but he's certainly no longer putting pressure on Anand's position. Anand is totally fine here. H6, rook d8, whatever you like.
Do you think he had any better move before? Because we did like his position a few moves back.
Yeah, but frankly, after rook a8, maybe he should have kept his e6 pawn pinned to avoid this idea with ed and e5, which I also missed. I think I even suggested queen before, but this just seems to solve black's problems on the spot, so he must have forgotten about that.
Queen takes e7 on the board. This is heading for a draw. That would mean that we would have Vasily so with 10 out of 16, and Vichy as well, 10 out of 16, with Magnus Carlsen on 9 out of 16, in case this game ends in a draw.
Yeah. Starting to wonder if Magnus, in spite of his structure, can still do anything because he controls the d-file. It doesn't really feel like there's no pawn breaks to work with. Black covers all the entry squares. He went rook d6, but yeah, let's say rook f6, but there's also other options. I find it very hard to believe this could be trouble. Then again, Magnus doesn't need much to work with. Still, black has to be fine here.
But if they make a draw, I also realize that Levon Aronian's victory could mean that he joins the leaders. 2 rounds ago, he said that this was a horrible tournament for him. He was not in a good shape, and now he might end up being the leader.
Yeah, field is still close together, so 2 victories with this 2-point system can get you up there. Levon decided not to play knight g3, which probably would have worked, just keeping as much extra material. Really no need for it. This is what I was talking about, knight e7, king h8. I guess you can capture on d5 or play any move, because rook takes f1 is not that big a threat. And if you just take here, takes, whatever. Bishop d8 or bishop f4. This should be a reasonably easy conversion task for the Armenian. Caruana did take on e5 in the meantime. Why not? Knight h3 didn't seem to work, so Kramnik goes for queen d6. Isn't this just a pawn? Knight takes g6, he wants queen takes, and then have a pretty nasty, admittedly, double threat, bishop f1, knight h3.
Yeah, he's winning the pawn back.
Yeah, and the f2 pawn would fall as well, so knight takes g6 probably is not ideal. But can't I go somewhere, let's say here? couldn't really see any dangerous. Oh, maybe still this.
Oh, but queen g3 check. King f1. Are we running away with king e2? Or I'm blundering?
No, but it still looks a little scary. Maybe there's nothing. Bishop h5, king d2. If the king makes it here, things should be good.
Well, luckily, the other bishop is not on d8 and could give a check on g5 or cut the king.
Indeed. Yeah, I can't see any tricks. Bishop f2, so feels like you can just take. The king can still run. Curious, but after this 8-second in-depth analysis, knight c4 seems to work reasonably well for white. And here's a pawn up, so Kramnik can't really afford to play slowly. MVL Topalov, yeah, has stabilized even further. I'm expecting a draw here, I think, at some point. You can even take here, well, let's say g3. Take this guy, put the knight on b5,
and you build can some never kind go of through. Fortress.
Yeah, maybe but the king goes to b5.
Black king, yeah, that's even better. So there's no king a4 ever. You cannot cross.
Yeah, should be equal. Oh, Vichy, fancy maneuvers, knight h8. I quite like it. He's improving his knight, puts it on f7, but still defends e5, but also covers the d6 square. Magnus.
Yeah, I like it. Looks very funny, but it's effective. With a knight on f7, as you said, the rook will have to leave the d6 square.
Yeah, Magnus also working on improving his knight, trying to bring it here. Curious if Vichy wants to exchange a pair of rooks or not. I'm not sure. Takes knight f7, rook d3, I would guess. F8. Should be fine for black, but black is quite passive here, so maybe Vichy's gonna try to do without exchanging the rooks, keep them on the board, knight f7, rook d3. Do something.
Even like this, it's not easy to activate the black rooks.
No. Still, yeah, it's one of these positions where you feel it has to be equal, but there's no way to force a draw, so you have to keep making sensible moves, and it's not the easiest thing to do against Magnus Carlsen.
Especially after the history they have in equal positions.
Yeah, knight Vichy f7. Agrees with me, doesn't want to exchange a pair of rooks, goes knight f7 directly, rook deck back to d3 is only move. And now you have to come up with a plan. Black would love to play b5, even if it ruined his pawn structure, just to free himself, but the problem is you won't see that pawn back after knight c4, so that's not possible just yet. What do you want to do, Vichy? It's more like knight g5, maybe? Nah, I guess not.
It still seems to be a tiny edge for white, knight g5, avoiding knight c4. Rook f5, I like that move. So if black captures, then after e takes f5, we would be happy to straighten the pawn structure and no e4 hanging pawn anymore.
Yeah, this would be bad news. h4, knight e4 would follow, therefore Vichy plays h6. After h6, h4, he still has to explain himself, because knight e6, it seems like rook takes
e5. Dropping the pawn, so if he has to go back to f7, that's very passive, because knight c4 will come.
Yeah, he can try to go to h7 and f6, maybe that is his plan.
He might do that, yeah. He went knight h7, knight b3, the knight is heading to c5. Attacking the weakness on b7.
Yeah, Magnus is adjusting immediately to the black knight's route, and wants to put his knight on c5 to defend his e4 pawn from there. Oh, he's playing beautiful chess as usual, with very limited means building up pressure on Alan's position. Still doesn't feel like it's beyond repair or anything, but white is certainly maneuvered very, very nicely.
And very unpleasant to play it with black. Has Aronian won already?
I'm not sure what's going on there. Like, we haven't seen a new move for a while after knight e7, king h8. Maybe Levon is trying to calculate it till the end. It's a tweet from Tarjei. He says, at this point in Paris GCT, Nakamura was leading. Now he's last and about to lose again.
Shocking, yes. That's true. We are also surprised. We thought that Nakamura would have a very good tournament here as well. He's in a good shape. Also in Rapid and Blitz, he's the second best in the world if we look at the ratings in Rapid and Blitz. So we did not think he would be in trouble.
Yeah, it's very much day to day. We've seen all kinds of guys have very good days and very bad days, and these are the best players in the world. So if you're something's bothering you or something's not working, like they're like do sharks like to hunt in packs? Probably not. Probably wolves. But whoever's vulnerable is
yeah, they go for the weak.
Often likely to lose a lot of games, even if it's one of the premier Rapid and Blitz players, and of course classical players in the world. But yeah, Hikaru as one of the two pre-tournament favorites, together with Magnus, of course, very surprised to see him struggling. And this game, yeah, it's a pure theory thingy, so I'm really not sure what happened here. Still, Levon just took a lot of time and went for the
G3.
Move G3, which looks very, very deep. I'm not sure I fully understand it.
Still, it's too deep because the bishop will be captured anyway.
Ah, I missed something. Even the
rook
good
f5,
thing is you can blunder a piece here and it doesn't matter all that much. You're still much better. But I didn't see this rook f5 resource. Maybe Levon also missed that from afar and had to adjust to it. Because here you still have to work for your point. Like you're still much better, but that's probably what bothered him, and that's why he went g3. He's happy even a tempo down to play this position. Any move? Oh no, I keep blundering
rook
f5.
I'll
stop blundering it in a second. So yeah, he might have complicated his task a little bit here.
Yeah, knight g3 looks just simple.
Just keeps three pieces versus three pieces and a rook versus two rooks, which is not a fair fight. Next move, bishop e2.
Yeah,
the game is pretty much over.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like there was anything. Maybe he was afraid of rook a2, or what move can be scary here?
Yeah, I'm not sure. Like, you have to make sure these rooks don't do too much damage, but it seems like white is everything under control.
We are slightly surprised by Levon Aronian's last moves, knight e7 and g3.
Garugu's rook a1 doesn't want to deal with this endgame where he only has one rook left. He's fishing for counterplay here.
Well, he will have to capture the bishop at some point.
I would guess so, yeah. He prefers the a3 pawn, but let's see. King d4, if you take on a3, then white has time to crawl out bishop h3. The three pieces are too strong. Still, all easier said than done over the board. Levon still has quite some questions to answer, and he hasn't executed ideally, but he does have big margin for error. What's going on here? I wrote this off as a draw like an hour ago, but all of a sudden, Veselin Topalov is a pawn up.
Wow, how did that happen?
I'm not sure. MVL went for c4, which, I don't know, looks like a winning attempt, but maybe...
Too much trying to win it?
Yeah, I'm not sure. This doesn't feel like he's playing for a win, feels like he's bungled it, frankly. King c5 looks logical, but then you have to deal with f4.
Yeah, he can lose this.
Yeah, he might be lost already. Strange.
C4.
Idea, the c4 move. But
there's just no way for in that position for black to get any winning chances unless you go crazy. King e5 is on the board, heading for those black pawns on the king side, but still, it doesn't feel right.
Feels like white should lose this race.
Yeah, definitely. Maxime.
Ah, there's knight d5 check here. That's a bit lucky, but I guess black can do better.
Yeah, but from a position where white was pushing, suddenly he has to find the most precise way to in order to draw.
Yeah, I don't think you can draw. I think it should just be lost. Like here, pawn queens, for example. Yeah. Bad news for Maxime. Let's check back in with Kramnik. Queen d6. Karana went for knight g4, not knight c4. I'm sure there's some deep tactics. But knight g4 gives black a breather to recapture his pawn. That's what he does. Rook d1, maybe that's what Fabiano was relying on. Knight to f4. Queen c3, threatening checkmate.
That's nasty. And in case of queen f8, you can play knight takes h6.
Yeah, I was curious if you can even do this.
Maybe that's better, because knight h6 is just a check, actually. Yeah, this seems to be bad. King h7 and queen takes f4.
Yeah, maybe you can get away with this. Not sure. Looks very dangerous. Might not be mate yet. Done now. Very, very tactical game. And as you mentioned, knight h6 also possible.
It's just a pawn though, so maybe knight f6 was a better idea.
We'll see how it goes. F6 would be a mistake because of bishop c4 check, picking up the queen. Else there is limited choice. Knight e6 is also a passive move you don't want to play. Probably runs into some sort of punishment. Knight h6. Something bad is going to happen. Kramnik's calculating. Aronian played strong move, king to d4. And Hikaru went rook c1. He's working on some sort of mating net with f6, rook d2. But it's very hard to believe he's going to have time for that.
Yeah, that takes two tempi, so I shall find a way to get out of it. Bishop g2 was played, so Levon really wants to give back one of the pieces and exchange a rook.
Yeah, but this piece I think he wants to keep. Now you can't take it because
yeah, you
the
have
rook
to
drops.
Take on h1, and then after bishop takes h1, it doesn't look like he can get back the piece. You are right. Rook takes h2 is just a pawn, and bishop takes d5. That position should be just completely winning.
Yeah, rook c4 check, king d5, maybe here something like rook g4, trying to get a hold of one of these bishops with this rook out of business on g4.
Yeah.
Once again, this is fairly easy. Rook c1, king e4, king f3.
What did he play? Rook d2?
When rook d2 check, which also should win back one piece, but not two. King e5, f6, and probably just king e6. Fairly hopeless. Yet again, takes, takes. Bishop d5. This dude should do the job. Levon went king d6, probably even stronger to support his b-pawn in the future. Now this is game over. Hikaru played rook c3. Can't allow any exchanges here because that makes White's life too easy. But this position as well, bearing something very dramatic. It's just hopeless. Bishop takes d5 or knight takes d5 or whatever you like.
Has anything happened in the Carlsen-Anand game?
Not a lot. Carlsen keeps activating his pieces to the max, but it doesn't look like
g6, h takes, king takes are the last moves. It does feel like that could be something. Rook d6. It's getting dangerous.
Yeah, it seems to me like black's defenses are still holding. I can't see any breakthroughs, at least. Still, black is very passive. Ah, there's a check on e6, which I missed, of course.
Mm-hmm. Thought you had a plan there after knight e6. Knight e6, knight d8 could be a funny maneuver.
Yeah, it looks dangerous all of a sudden. Just take the pawn. No, impressive positional chess by Carlsen. I'm not good enough at this stuff to explain everything he's doing, but yeah, effortlessly he's put his pieces
incredible
dominating squares from an endgame that really doesn't look all that scary, because if anybody has a better pawn structure, it's black.
This could be the third game Magnus Carlsen wins in a row. Is it the third or fourth? No, third. After having lost two games yesterday. And Vishy Anand, on the other hand, entered the day as the tournament leader and has just lost a game. This will be his second defeat.
Yeah, I'm not so sure he's losing here, so he certainly can still put up a fight, but he is under pressure. He plays king g7, allowing knight e6, and after knight e6, I guess you go back.
And if rook takes e5, even threatening knight f4 check, maybe he just hopes that since the e-pawns are doubled, this pawn up for white is still not so dangerous, but the pieces are very active too.
Yeah, not sure what the idea is. Maybe he wants to exchange something with rook d7 here at least.
Knight f8, we couldn't play before. No, you take rook f8, there's no yeah. trick. Mm-hmm. No, that would be just... Yeah, no, nothing. That doesn't work.
Knight 6 check, king g6 is on the board. I can't see anything wrong with rook takes e5 at the very least. So yeah, Magnus doing Magnus things.
That seems like the secret, at least for Magnus in this event, is not to care, because that's what he said. This is how he dealt with yesterday's losses.
And Levon has given one piece back, but the rest of his army is fully activated, and now it's the black king that's in trouble. Bishop f5 check is in the air.
Yeah, this is
fairly hopeless.
Mating net, it seems. Oh, beautiful.
Yeah, just to illustrate.
No, unfortunately for Hikaru Nakamura, this isn't the best tournament he is having, and it's just a week after his success in Paris. But yeah, the blitz is still to come. 18 rounds of blitz chess starting tomorrow, and he's very good at blitz.
Kramnik decided to parry this mating threat by going knight to e6, which looked a little passive, and Fabiano played bishop c2, queen c5, rook c4, queen g5, rook d5, queen h4, king h2. Seems like Fabiano has not only stabilized and activated his armory, but also kept his, I was going to say extra pawn, but he doesn't have an extra pawn, so that wouldn't be true. Kept his initiative alive, unless bishop takes f2 works, but I doubt it. g3, yeah, it's just winning material.
I think Magnus played knight d8, if I can see it correctly, instead of grabbing the pawn.
Yeah, he did.
So the idea is just paralyzing black's pieces.
Yeah, it's hard to make a move. Rook c7, knight e6 is not ideal. Very impressive positional display. Rook e8, knight b7, I guess works.
Could this be a zugzwang?
Knight e6. Yeah, it doesn't look good. Rook h7 is the best move you got, you're in trouble here.
Yeah, but then the e5 pawn drops.
Exactly.
And c5 is not a move that helps.
Well, c5, you could even just play b3 and say.
Exactly. He can always go king g2 too. Like, white has a lot of moves. Black is running out of moves. This position is incredible. Equal material, but black's pieces are paralyzed. Magnus Carlsen has played a brilliant game against Vishy Anand and seems to be winning.
Yeah, I can't see him off. Vishy, of course, understands he's in trouble. But all credit to Magnus in this one, really. From a very innocuous position. Maybe it wasn't that innocuous, but to my eyes, yeah, it looked like nothing special. He's built up a very, very serious initiative.
I think we have a tweet from Jonathan Rosen,
if we can
bring that up later about Magnus's game.
I'm sure he's saying something artsy and poetic.
Yes, watching Magnus squeeze Vishy, the kind of position where you need mental toughness to survive. That's true, and Vishy seems like he was not tough enough mentally to survive this equal position against Magnus Carlsen. Now this position seems to be already quite desperate.
Yeah, I'm not sure if mental toughness helps you here, like a pawn on g7 or something would be nice, but
I guess he meant like 10 moves ago. And of course, you can all tweet us by using the hashtag GrandChessTour. So any opinions, ideas, questions, photos, hashtag GrandChessTour.
MVL is trying to find a way out of this mess he got himself into. I'm curious if he wants to take on f5, but it doesn't seem to work yet. My point is, if black is left with his h-pawn and the wrong bishop, you could still escape with a draw. But here, I guess you're on time to do this. b6, just take. b7, bishop a7.
Yeah, you will not get the e-pawn, but Jan was saying that endgame is with a bishop and a pawn up, so nothing for white, but wrong corner. So only the h-pawn left, and the h1 corner is light color. The bishop is the opposite color, so that's a theoretical draw if the king gets to the corner.
Doesn't seem to work though, so I can't really see an escape for MVL here, who's ruined his position by going for the c4 break.
What's the point of c4? What do you think he missed? He thought that he will just break through king c3, king c4, and the b-passed pawn is too strong?
I don't know, maybe he missed bishop takes h2. I'm not sure.
Yeah, if the pawn was on h3 in this position, then this idea could have made sense, clearing the way for the king entering the position, and this passed pawn could cause several problems for black.
Indeed. How's Fabi doing? Took on h6.
Kaas and Anand has finished. We see the players analyzing. It must mean that Vishy Anand resigned in this position where this is a zugzwang. I think he played rook from e7 to e8, and after knight takes b7. Oh, c5 is also on the board, so c5, b3. Complete zugzwang. And the world champion beats former world champion. We have seen this matchup many times. And once again, the same story. Carson having an equal position, maybe tiny edge or not even that, but pushing and putting a lot of pressure on Vishy Anand, who has lost his second game now in a row.
Yeah, very nice game by Magnus. Can't blame Vishy or lack of form or anything. I think that was just very impressive display by Carlsen. I criticized him for this move, queen b4, allowing this freeing operation, but he probably judged from much further away that this endgame he can put up some pressure, and he did.
I seriously started to think that we bring luck to the players, because all the people who have appeared, except for Maxime, but Levon, Magnus and Wesley, so they are having a very good day today here in Leuven, so it must be because of us.
Levon won his game in the meantime against Hikaru. Yeah, that was very strange, because all of this stuff is known, at least to me, and if it's known to me, it's probably also known to these guys, and leads to more or less a forced loss. The tricky part is to find this queen c3, queen a1 maneuver. Levon took a bit of time, but then he either remembered or reproduced it or found it. And yeah, the game was over more or less, so theoretical loss for Hikaru Nakamura. He's not having a great tournament.
What about the Vashier Topalov game? It seems that Maxime has entered the king side with his king, but he will not manage to capture all the pawns.
Yeah, f4 maybe. Seems to be just lost. King h5, I guess even f3. Knight e6 check, king wherever else it takes. This pawn is very fast.
It doesn't seem like white can stop both passed pawns.
Wesley's calculating. I'm not sure, maybe h4 also works. He's trying to make up his mind, but h4, knight f5 strikes me as less clear cut. Might also win though. Bishop f2. Nah. No, this is too dangerous. Well, this was winning, probably. And if knight h6. six. Should also be winning. Bishop e3, bishop four, bishop g1.
Yeah, this seems to be hopeless. The king is not close enough. The white king will not manage to get back. I think a lot of things have happened in the game between Caruana and Vladimir Kramnik as well, if we can have a look at it quickly.
Yeah, knight h6, king h7, Fabiano went knight f5. And what is this?
Trying to understand it, but so far I did not manage.
Cd is half understandable, but expect him to grab the queen. Dc4 and knight g6, which looks nice for white. But instead, Fabiano went ed5.
He has sacrificed the whole rook, it seems. It's true that the knight on e6 is hanging and the queen is also hanging, but the f, it just, wow. But the point is that now after e takes d5, the rook will appear on h4 and also the g7 square is pretty much targeted.
This mate, queen f6, rook h4, king g8, queen f6, gf,
bishop takes
f6.
And you can't do anything, can you?
King on knight g7. Couldn't see a mate yet. That doesn't mean there can't be one.
And I think we'll once again have a guest. You guys have 10 seconds to guess who it is. He is from the Netherlands. Wow, what a difficult question. We are being joined by Anish Giri, who will explain his game of round 8 of the Rapid in Leuven. Welcome, Anish.
Anish, nice little break, reproducing some files. Ah, you don't have a mic?
After two losses, some people try to stop the bleeding, and I didn't even have to try because he just entered a line which ended in a theoretical perpetual.
So all this line was in your computer and possibly his as well, yeah?
Yeah, I guess I didn't really remember rook takes b5, but I assumed that there is something for a piece, so I found the draw.
No, I got a bit confused because, yeah, the main line is without the rook on b1, and all of I first thought you had mixed up the move order, but...
No, no, there are some subtle differences, obviously.
So, what's going on? Did you just lose the flow in the first game and then it was hard to get back into it, or
No, I think they're separate games. In the first game, the price of a move was so low in the opening that I thought that I can make any moves. Just I should not do it slowly. And then I played this move rook e8 because I was lazy to calculate knight h5, which was very good. Knight h5, knight g5, I thought. And knight h5.
Oh, sorry.
Knight g5, queen g6, knight e6, and I kind of, I don't know, I just stopped it, but there is just rook f6. And, okay, it's not as trivial, but ed, rook d5, knight f4, black has fantastic play. Black is actually, knight c7, knight f4, I mean.
Oh, sorry.
So. Yeah, this is wonderful for black. So I played rook e8 because I didn't see that, and I thought, okay, I can make any move. But then suddenly it turns out that all of my pieces are positioned exactly for b4. And at least if my rook was on not on d7, I could play knight d7. You know, if everything, if something would be different, I would be okay. But after that it's bad, but I still had some chances, but I messed it up. And this next game was entirely different.
One question here, because I couldn't see a win after c4, queen
takes d3. I was afraid of queen b2, queen c3.
Queen c3.
Queen takes c3, knight c3, rook a3. Knight d1, I didn't believe that I can save my knight, but I actually save it, I think. But I didn't believe that it can work, I don't know.
No,
I missed knight d1, I think. I thought rook d1, then take, and he's just trapped. But it's still much better for white, this position, obviously.
Have an important question regarding this round, the game between Maxim Vachier and Veselin Topalov. How do you evaluate this endgame?
I don't see the position at the moment.
One second.
We will bring it up just in a moment. And
he had a very easy draw with knight takes f5. Oh, this is a draw, yeah? Complete draw. But he was maybe lost at some point.
Must have been lost.
Oh, wait, why is it a draw? No, it's not a complete draw, sorry. No, it is. Yeah, it is a complete draw, yeah?
King G2, no, it is a complete draw.
Yeah. Okay, King G2, King D5. Just to be very sure.
I'll find a way to lose it.
Just to be completely sure. Knight F3. No, this is draw, but can you go back? Knight F3, H3 check. Okay, now let's go Bishop H4. I don't know, try to confuse you. Just, I don't know. Well, it's a draw, no? But Knight H2, Knight G4, Knight F2.
Oh yeah, now we're in time.
Yes.
And if I don't play Bishop H4, now I play some move King C4 or something.
King
E2? But does... you mean just ending, yeah? Yeah, it's not so trivial, but you can show a very nice moment when he could take on F5 early on.
It seems that Vasily Topalov missed something before.
Here, F5, B5, he played. Bishop G1, knight takes F5, draws on the spot here.
Knight F5 here?
Yeah. GF, King E5, Bishop E1, King F5. King E4 and...
this is the draw you wanted to get.
This is what he wanted to get, but then with five moves less.
That is odd, yeah.
And then at some point he was on the verge of losing, but... So what's the current position?
This is it.
Yeah, it's
white to move, or...?
It is white to move.
Yeah, King E6 last move.
Knight E4, H3, King F1. Yeah, it's a draw. Bishop H4, Knight G5, check.
Taken. I think they will play until they grab all the pawns and then we'll shake hands. Missed opportunities in this game. We have one last question. How is it to play a tournament without having your other half here, without Sofiko Guramishvili supporting you?
Yeah, it's very difficult, as you can see. I'm suffering very badly. But okay, I'm. We are still in touch, and I have somebody to cry to after my losses, so it's okay.
All right, best of luck for the last round.
Catch him with
Anish Giri. Fabian Caruana has checkmated Vladimir Kramnik in very nice style. We should show you the final position here.
I think this rook d5, when the rook is being captured on d5, we should go back to that moment because it was impressive that he didn't want to take the queen on e7. Knight h6, of course, it cannot be captured because of the hanging queen on f6 after king f8, bishop a3, and that's it. Knight c5 was still played, but the king cannot hide. And after queen e7, a beautiful last move, knight f5. Doesn't matter that the queen is hanging on c5 because rook h8 is mate.
Yeah, good stuff by Fabiano. Nice game for him. Levon Aronian won his game. Anish Giri, as mentioned, theoretical draw. Magnus Carlsen won a very nice game against Vishy Anand. So where does all that stuff leave us in the standings?
We shall have a look at the standings because I think several things will change after Vishy's loss, Carlsen winning, and Vasily drew. So that leaves us with 10 points for Magnus Carlsen, just like Aronian and so. So we have a tie between three players on the first place, followed by Caruana and Anand with 9. So this is still... It could mean that any of these five players can win the rapid bit of the event. Of course, nothing is decided because there will be 18 more games in Blitz Chess. So this is just the first half of the event.
Exciting final round ahead. Stay tuned. It's going to start in... this was a quick round, so it's going to start in around 25 minutes. We'll be back a bit before that to talk you through the pairings and all the action to come.
I think while I let you leave, Jan, I will go and ask our audience who do they cheer for.
So. Do you think? See you soon.